I'm very pleased that we are at the beginning of my presentation. I'm also very pleased that there are so many young people. I didn't expect that, because Alzheimer's, it's a disease of the aging population. But you're here, and you're here to learn more about Alzheimer's disease. And I'm going to try you to inform you about the state of the art of Alzheimer's disease and the Alzheimer blood test. So these are the three subjects that I will discuss in the next 30 to 40 minutes with you. So what is dementia, and what are biomarkers in dementia? How to perform biomarker studies, and what's the state of the art in Alzheimer blood test development? Before I start, I would like to know of you, what's your relation with Alzheimer's disease or dementia? So whom of you has a relative or someone near you with dementia? Please raise your hands. That's not a majority for tonight, but quite a substantial number of people. And it's also reflected in the numbers that we see over here. So there's substantial growth in dementia prevalence. So when you can see here over here, in 2015, the daily burden of disease, the disease burden of Alzheimer's disease, it was somewhere really at a lower bottom. But it's expected to rise for 2040 to be the highest among the major diseases over here. So, and it's of course due to the aging population. And we do have, and it's a major societal problem, because we have an increase in the aging people, yet at the same time we have a smaller group of younger people that are able to take care of the aging people. And this really has a burden, not only on the well-being of people, but also on the cost and the quality of care, and also logistics. I'm also familiar with Alzheimer's disease myself. I have a friend with Alzheimer's disease. And due to her example, I became very much aware of the importance of biomarkers. And through this presentation, I hope that you also get very well aware of the importance of biomarkers. But I also want to share my enthusiasm and my hope for a better future for treating Alzheimer's disease. And with my friend, it started with some cognitive complaints. And she forgot things. So she couldn't just go to my house without Google Maps, although she was able to do that always. That was not a problem at all. But in the beginning, we thought, no, that's not possible. You're much too young. She was only 45, 46. So we thought, no, that's not possible. It cannot be dementia. But when her complaints continued, yeah, we started thinking that it was something very serious. And she went to the doctors, and finally the doctors were convinced that they should refer her to the Amsterdam Memory Clinics. And there she got a lumbar puncture to obtain the cerebrospinal fluid. And within the cerebrospinal fluid, in my lab, we analyzed Alzheimer biomarkers. And having seen the results of these biomarkers, it's happened what we feared so much, but it was also very clear this was Alzheimer's disease. And for her, it was of course very sad for all of us, I have to say. But it was also a relief, because it explained what her complaints were. It was clear that she was not crazy. She encountered that kind of emotions when she forgot things, that people thought that she was crazy. And it was really a clarification of what's happening to her. So this gives you the idea that how important a good diagnosis is. And in Alzheimer's, we do that with the help, very strong help, of Alzheimer biomarkers. And this also shows why it's so important to work on it. And with this example, I will also express my drive to get to a solution for this dreadful disease. So before I go into the depth of Alzheimer's biomarkers, I need to explain to you what is dementia. And funny enough, last week, Friday, the day before World Alzheimer's Day, there was a report, World Alzheimer's Report appeared. It's a report that appears every year. And this time it had as topic the attitudes to dementia. And one of the questions was, is dementia caused by normal aging? So we can compare ourselves to the rest of the world. So by this, I want to ask you, what do you think? Is Alzheimer's caused by normal aging? Is that the cause? Who thinks it is? So you're already a bit informed, maybe. So if we compare ourselves to the rest of the world, we can conclude over here, 2 out of 3 people, so quite a substantial number, think that dementia is caused by normal aging. Well, that's, for me, it's a surprise, but of course, it's my field. So I want to convince you now that it's not part of normal aging. And dementia, it's an umbrella term. So it is the explanation of a lot of syndromes that are all associated with cognitive decline. So there are memory problems. But dementia is then a group of syndromes, and Alzheimer's disease is the most prevalent one. So it accounts for 50 to 70% of all dementia cases. So it's very important, but dementia is not Alzheimer's disease. Dementia can also be something else. So the second most prevalent form of dementia is vascular dementia. It goes along with vascular problems within the brain, small hemorrhages, for example, which can be the cause. The third most prevalent in the aging population is Lewy body dementia. That's a dementia type that has some similarities with Parkinson's disease. So there can be motor symptoms, and there are also hallucinations. And the fourth most prevalent one is frontotemporal dementia. And that's also a very peculiar dementia because it goes along with inhibition. So a patient can come to the doctor and just put the coat on the floor. But that's quite an innocent example. It can also be that they have a gambling problem or overeating. So those are the 4 most prevalent forms of dementia, but there are more. But Alzheimer's is what we're talking about tonight. And Alzheimer's is defined by very specific changes in proteins. And you have proteins in everywhere in your body, and you eat them. But in Alzheimer's disease, there are specific changes in specific proteins, especially the amyloid and the tau protein. And the amyloid and tau proteins, they accumulate, they clump and aggregate. And that's abnormal, and that's probably the cause of Alzheimer's disease. Maybe not the cause, but it's a really characteristic form. So going to this example, you can see over here a healthy neuron at the left part. It has a cell body, it's glimpsing also, and you have a nice dendrites and axons, so they are able, these are the structures that are important for transmission of the signal from one neuron to the other. And here in Alzheimer's brain, you see immediately that it's different. You see some kind of small ball of wool, and this is the plaque. And plaque consists of mainly of the amyloid beta protein. Over here, you see also that the neuronal cell body is not shining anymore. Within this neuron, there are tangles formed, and they consist mainly of abnormal accumulation, aggregations of tau protein. So it's amyloid and tau. That's how Alzheimer's disease is nowadays defined. It's also an important question to know whether Alzheimer's has a genetic cause. Because people know that in their family they may have Alzheimer's disease, so you can be worried that you can also get the disease. Well, there are some genetic forms, mainly genes that are changed they are mutated and or abnormal in the Alzheimer's, in the amyloid processing genes. So the I won't tell you the name because you will forget them anyway. But presenilin and APP, I do tell them. A very important one is APOE, APOE4. That's a quite prevalent gene, and it increases your risk of getting Alzheimer's disease. But it's there are not so many people, but it's quite common still. And there are very very common genes in which you can have different alleles, but they are not increasing the risk as high as APOE or the Alzheimer's genes. So, and probably they interact with each other, so it's quite enigmatic still what their function is and how this relates to Alzheimer's disease. So yes, there is a genetic component. But on the other hand, especially in the non-familial diseases, we don't know exactly how this leads to Alzheimer's disease, and it's just an increased risk. And of course, aging is very important. So now I come to the subject of biomarkers. Why do we need biomarkers? Now, in neurology, we're not able to take a biopsy of the affected tissue, as you can do maybe in some cancers. So it's very important that we have add-on measures, biological measures, for diagnosis. So we need to have a diagnosis, correct diagnosis for either Alzheimer's or the other forms of dementia. That's very important. We also need biomarkers for prognosis. So we want to be able to inform a patient much better at the time of diagnosis how the disease course will be. Will they be able to live forever? Probably not. But how quickly will the disease proceed? Can they still live with their family, or do they need to take some additional measures for care? So that's very important. And we also need biomarkers for monitoring of treatment response. Given the fact that in Alzheimer's disease it's biologically defined, it's very important to have a very objective measure, so biomarkers, to monitor whether a treatment has an effect. And the advantage in Alzheimer's disease is that we are nowadays able to measure the real proteins that are affected in different ways. So we can measure it by amyloid scans. It's a special PET scan, so imaging method. And here you see a brain seen from the top. Here are the body fluids, here's the cerebrospinal fluid. And the more binding of this tracer to amyloid, the more signal. So the redder and the yellow color, they indicate a lot of binding. So this is a real life example. So you can clearly see in Alzheimer's disease there's a lot of binding of this PET ligand to the amyloid protein, whereas it's absent in controls. But coming to our subject, luckily we're also able to measure amyloid changes in the cerebrospinal fluid, in the brain fluid. So we can measure changes in the amyloid protein and also in the tau protein. So in several proteins simultaneously. And the combination of the two, alterations in the cerebrospinal fluid is defining Alzheimer's disease. And through these biomarkers, we've been able to make a lot of important conclusions. So due to these biomarkers, we came to realize that Alzheimer's disease starts already up to 20 years before we see the clinical symptoms. So I think it's also scary, because if you imagine that a disease starts as symptomatic after age 60, so age 40 already, the disease starts to accumulate, so the biology starts. So that also means that we really need biomarkers, because we can't see the symptoms in this early stage. So we need those biomarkers to identify the right patients that we want to treat. And next, we also need biological markers as outcome measures, because still we can't measure the clinical symptoms. So we're really dependent on the biomarkers for our treatments. And that's a very important concept, And it has also changed the fields. And this concept has started to, or has landed in the research area only 1.5 years ago. It's more established now. But you can imagine that not everyone is already aware of that. But nowadays, Alzheimer's disease is defined by these biological changes. And based on literature, on many studies that have been performed, these graphs of trajectories have been developed. And here, so you can see that here's normal. Now, let's hope that we are normal, but you never know. And but we see amyloid beta going up already and in the cognitively normal. So those are persons that may come to a memory clinic. They may be worried about their memory, but we can't find any changes on cognitive tests. And in this stage, we see only amyloid changes. But here, there's some tau changes, atrophy, shrinkage of the brain starts already. But only later, when there is clinical dementia, we see the clinical symptoms. So now I come to my second question from the survey. And I already saw in the beginning that we are an atypical population here. So we're not among the 17,000 respondents from those 155 countries, probably. One of the questions was also, do lifestyle factors contribute to dementia risk? So who of you think that is the case? That's really a majority, and that makes me also happy, because then we're more like the general population, or maybe still not so much, because we were in a majority thinking that it's important. And only half of the people around the world do think that lifestyle factors play a role in developing dementia. Well, the answer, according to the state of the art, of the science, is yes, they probably do. So it's mainly the risk factors that are also bad for your heart, are also bad for developing dementia. So like smoking, drinking too much, and obesity, so all those kinds of things. So you know already it's very important to live healthy, but now for your heart, but also now for another reason. So now I come to the second subject. How do we perform biomarker studies? Well, a biomarker study usually follows this development workflow. So we start with biomarker identification. We can do this by large screening methods. We can compare protein profiles, measure all kinds of proteins within the cerebrospinal fluid or within the blood. And once we've done this identification, we continue with assay development. And assay development means, for protein chemistry, that you use ELISA methods. Now, that's technical details, but it can use, yeah, it's a difficult name, and it's also expressing how difficult it is to develop novel tests. Step three, we go to clinical validation. So once we're successful in developing a test, often we are not, then we move on with clinical validation. So we want to know whether this test really works, not only in a small group, not only in Alzheimer's versus controls, but we also want to know, is it also valid in Alzheimer's versus FTD or versus Lewy body dementia? And is it not only valid in Amsterdam, but also in other populations around the world? So that needs to be done. And once we've undergone that process, so I think normally we're here already in year 15 or something, and then there is implementation. So we need to develop a product that can be used throughout the world, and that's when we finally can start to use a biomarker. So in the past, this has taken on average 20 years. So for the Alzheimer biomarkers in cerebrospinal fluid that we use now, it took 20 years. And of course, we want to accelerate that. It's unacceptable that it takes that long for such an urgent disease. And with our studies, we take advantage of a large biobank, and that's what we need. A biobank is a collection of samples, patient samples, controls, And samples are small samples of cerebrospinal fluid. It can also be blood. And in Amsterdam, we are in a very luxurious position. It's a really large treasure box that we sit on, because we have a biobank of more than 5,000 patient samples. So more than 5,000 patients and controls, all kinds of dementia patients, have donated their CSF, the cerebrospinal fluid, and blood for us to do research. So in that way, we are really able to follow all those steps in biomarker development. But it's not so easy to develop those biomarkers, and often we are already stuck in this first step between 1 and 2. So we do our biomarker identification, but we are not able to develop a test. But nowadays we also have novel possibilities and technological possibilities for which I think we can overcome those hurdles. And one of the options is to apply a method that has been developed also for large screening. And those methods, they were not available like 5 years ago. And here we use this method, and through this method we are able to analyze more than 1,000 different proteins in the cerebrospinal fluid, but also in blood of dementia patients. And here are the different disease mechanisms. Here it's the different kinds of body fluids that they used. But they also cover a lot of disease mechanisms relevant in neurological diseases, but also in cancer. So these panels, these tests, they can be used also for other disease indications. And I'll give you an example of a study that we performed. This is a unique cohort. It's the largest study of its kind. And in the study, we aim to identify novel biomarkers using this Olink technology for different dementia types. So we've included almost 200 controls, over 280 patients, 200 FTD, and 100 Lewy body dementia patients. And I'll show you just one result, which is very promising, and that's why I'm also so optimistic that this is the way to go. Here we compared the levels of those proteins in Alzheimer patients compared to controls. If a bar is red, it means it's increased in Alzheimer's disease. So you can immediately see all those proteins, they were elevated in Alzheimer's disease, and none were decreased, so lower in Alzheimer's disease. And we were able to identify 61 proteins that were elevated. So of course we continue with these, and that's part of ongoing research. We have other measures, we have other ideas and other projects to overcome all the hurdles that we encountered in biomarker studies. And for that, we were awarded a grant, a very large grant of the European Union. It's called Myriade, and it's a Marie Curie training program. So I will do some advertisement here, because we can hire 15 PhD students. Mobility is important, so there must be exchange throughout Europe, and they will all work on our subject. So the steps that I just showed you, which are the logical steps in the biomarker development lifetime, but they also will work on process innovation and biocomputation. So it's not only lab people that we're looking for, but also biocomputational specialists. And this is a very busy slide. This expresses how busy we will be in this project, but it also indicates all the partners. So if you're interested to have mobility, to travel around Europe, but even to Korea, so please send us an email to indicate and show your interest. The only thing you can't do if you're from Amsterdam or from the Netherlands, you're not able to do your PhD with us. You have to go abroad. But I think that's not a problem for you if you want to travel the world. So now I have to celebrate the cocktails of this evening. Hmm. So I try to be alcohol free, but from now on I will speak quicker, probably. But now I come to a sensitive issue. Do we want early testing? Because that's an important ethical issue. Why do we want to know an early diagnosis? You're also young, you all came. I thought there would be a lot of older people that want to be tested. But I'm but maybe you want to be tested. So we again go to this survey, and of course we didn't have any blood tests at the time of this survey. But the question was, do you want to have early testing? So that's now my question to you, and surprise me. Who wants to have early testing of if the blood test is available? All my colleagues don't want. No, they know too well how good our tests are. Yes, of course we don't, it's about half-half, that people want to get tested. The question was asked in the World Alzheimer Report on genetic testing. I think it's comparable because it shows your increased risk, and probably that's also the kind of information we will give you if you're young and and the test is available and we do the blood testing. But 82% of the people would like to know their risk, so do a genetic test to learn about your risk. I think that's quite high, and if we extrapolate that to blood testing, I think there is quite some interest in early blood testing. But that's not where we are aiming for now in our Alzheimer blood test, and I will explain it in a minute. So now I'll move on with state of the art of the blood test development for Alzheimer's disease. Of course, we were very happy and satisfied with our cerebrospinal fluid tests and also with the PET scans. But they also come with disadvantages. So CSF is obtained in specialized memory clinic. It can be perceived as invasive, which means also that people can be anxious for it. It is more invasive than a blood test. It can go along with headache, only in 10%, and it's also manageable. But still, this fear is there, and also this risk is there. For a PET scan, it's very expensive. It's also only possible in just a few very specialized memory clinics. And it also goes along with some radioactivity that has to be injected. So that is very clear that there is a need for blood tests, especially if you want to do repeated testing. And blood test analysis has not been possible until a few years ago. But the technological developments, not only in the O-Link panel technology that I just showed you, but also other technologies have really improved. And now we have the Simoa technology. And the Simoa technology is able to measure very low concentrations. And that's what we need for brain-specific proteins. Simoa, it stands for single molecule analysis, and it's analyzed with this machine. It's like two refrigerators big. And the first results with this Simoa technology came not for the amyloid proteins, but for another brain-specific protein. It's called neurofilament light. And neurofilament light is a protein that's present in the axons of the neurons. So the axon, that's the long part that transmits the signal. And neurofilament is the cytoskeleton, part of the cytoskeleton of the axons. So if there is axonal damage, neurofilament light can be released from the axons, and it is measurable in the cerebrospinal fluid, in the brain fluid. In quite decent concentrations, we were able to measure with conventional methods, but at much lower concentrations, about 50 times lower concentrations than in CSF, it's present in blood. And for this, we really need very high sensitive, ultra sensitive methods like Simoa. And using Simoa, we were able to show that neurofilament light is not only an interesting diagnostic biomarker, but it is a biomarker that can be used also for monitoring of treatment effects. And here in this example, you can see how that has worked. So here are the neurofilament levels at baseline in multiple sclerosis patients, other neurological disease. And you see the levels are 30. In healthy subjects, they are around 15 at baseline. But patients were treated either with placebo in blue or with an MS therapy. And it's very clear that with this therapy, the neurofilament light levels at month 6, they were almost at the level of the normal population. So with this, we really have an objective tool to show if there is any treatment effects. So you may wonder if there was any treatment effect, because maybe neurofilament light goes down and there is no treatment effects, then it's still useless, but there was. So it's a very important biomarker for treatment response. And that was neurofilament light. So due to these results, we got also inspired to analyze other brain-specific proteins in the blood, whether that was possible as well. And we were not the only ones. There were many other groups that simultaneously were developing tests for amyloid in the blood. And of course, in the past, people also tried to measure it, but the results were always, one side up or another group found nothing or downregulation, so we couldn't make anything of it. But now, all of a sudden, everyone started to get the same results, whatever test they used. So there are multiple groups working on it, but showing the same effects. So all showed a decrease in this amyloid in blood in Alzheimer's patients. So here you see an extract of all kinds of different studies, and I'm proud of one of them that we did in our lab using a commercial kit based on the Simoa. And we observed that plasma amyloid was already decreased in Alzheimer's patients in their earliest stage. But they came to our memory clinic. So based on these results, we concluded that it's relevant to use this blood test as a pre-screener. So if someone is anxious for going to undergo a lumbar puncture, or a doctor can also be anxious to administer a lumbar puncture to obtain the cerebrospinal fluid, a blood test is at hand and you can use it. So that's the idea for it, but of course we need some developments. So what we did observe was that in the early stage of those Alzheimer patients, they were not yet Alzheimer dementia patients, they were not yet demented, but they had the changes in the CSF only. And we observed that in 70% we already observed this decrease in amyloid. And the blood test is not yet perfect. That's what you can see over here. So in dementia patients, we observed that the blood test showed a decrease in amyloid in 85% of the patients. So we were happy with it. We were here at the state of an assay development. It was developed and we wanted to go for large clinical validation, but we were not yet happy enough with it. So we decided to develop a novel test. And here were the first proof of concept results generated with our novel test. And we were very happy with it because we saw a nice discrimination. So we observed a nice decrease in AD patients compared to the controls in this plasma A-beta level. But also that this distance between those box plots, as we call them, it was quite substantial. So we were very happy with it. We continued developing with this test. But the appearance of those proof of concept results, and we have showed them at the Alzheimer International Conference, and people were so enthusiastic about it, and that was a year ago. And it was also at the time that my inaugural lecture was happening. So we made a press release, and then there was an overwhelming response to it. So we had a lot of media exposure. So at Jeroen Pauw, we came to explain our test. This is also at Jeroen Pauw. The next day, I made a promotion. I could go to RTL 5 o'clock show, drinking sherry with Dave and Donnie Roelvink. So the company really was getting better. In about a month later, I obtained was awarded this Viva Knappe Koppen or Knappe Koppen award. And then at the end, well, I was there, but at the end of the year, things happened without my knowledge also, and completely out of control, I think. So I was listed in the AD, the 19 of 2019, and really now I was in good company. So this is me, next to Theresa May and Jesse Klaver, Robert Mueller, and Max Verstappen. So where are we now with for the evaluation of our blood test? We expanded our cohort because if you looked very carefully, we only had 20 AD patients, 20 controls, so that's very small. And one experiment is not an experiment, so you need to replicate. And that's what we did in a larger cohort in which we also defined the amyloid positivity by a PET scan. So here are the results. Now there is a little bit more of overlap, but still we observe the decrease in Alzheimer's patients compared to controls. But we also added other proteins to it, because I just showed you the amyloid and the tau and how important they are, but that's not a complete story. There are other mechanisms involved. There is inflammation inside the brain. There's astrocytosis. So there are difficult terms to make you very aware that there is a lot happening that we don't know yet. And one of these markers that we identified or thought that it could be very promising was this GFAP protein. And also this one, we see a nice difference between AD patients and controls. So the amyloid positives and the amyloid negatives. So that's another protein that we will add to our blood test. In the meanwhile, for tau, we also want to have a nice test, because if you remember, for the cerebrospinal fluid, we base our diagnosis on amyloid and tau. So we also want to have a tau blood test. And for that, it's the same, you could almost say, boring story as for amyloid. We were not able to measure it in a reliable way, but now we are able to do that. And this is done by another PhD student in our group. So here, this plasma p-tau assay, you also see a very nice discrimination between the AD patients, so they have higher p-tau levels compared to controls. And this increase, it's also in line with our expectations and what we see in the cerebrospinal fluid. So it's very promising. She also immediately checked whether how this p-tau assay relates to the PET positivity. She didn't wait a year like we did with the amyloid blood test. And here she also observed there was an increase in the PET positive patients. So that's really in line with everything that we thought. So where are we now? So we are at a state that we need to replicate and do clinical validation in large patient cohorts. And for that, we started a collaboration with groups all over the world. As a matter of fact, we were able to choose, because after our presentation at the Alzheimer's conference, many groups came to us and they wanted to use our amyloid blood test. And these are researchers that also have a high cohort, a large cohort, not as big as us, of course. They offered their samples to us for an analysis using our amyloid blood test. So we just picked out the people that we liked the most and that had the nice cohorts. And those are a group from the United States, Douglas Galasco, very friendly guy, and Colin Masters from Australia. Oh, and very important, of course, we also want to bring our product to the market. So we developed our amyloid blood test together with a small company called ADX Neurosciences. They're in Belgium. And now we made also a collaboration with Quanterix, which is the producer of the Simoa, the nice machine. And we agreed together that we want to have this assay available for all over the world within a year. So that's where we will work on in the upcoming year, together with them. So I think, or I hope, that I clarified to you the importance and also the state of the art of in biomarker development for dementia, how important it is for therapy development, and also that we are busy with developing blood tests for Alzheimer's disease, but also for other dementias, because we don't have any clues yet. We have fewer tools than for Alzheimer's dementia when we go for Lewy body dementia or for frontotemporal dementia. So we want to look at different biomarkers, and some may be detectable, like neurofilament, both in CSF and in blood. Others may be detectable only in CSF, so we won't exclude them. I think for diagnosis, it's still very relevant to develop such CSF biomarkers, cerebrospinal fluid. And we already have a nice panel now with GFAP, tau, amyloid beta, and neurofilaments. So I hope that I convince you of the importance of it, and I think, and I'm very optimistic, that with those biomarkers we will be able to accelerate a cure for Alzheimer's disease. And that's my sincere hope. And at the end, I have to thank a lot of people, because I'm here, but I'm just representing a group of a large group of many hardworking people that thrive the same aim as I do. We want to develop biomarkers for dementias. So here they are, and thank you for your attention.